As far as I can remember, in fact, from the third grade until just a few years ago when I had eye surgery, I wore glasses. And I can remember when I moved into really my adult years that without my glasses, I was considered to be legally blind. And that was not fun. That was quite miserable. I would wake up in the morning, look at the clock, and just kind of guess what time it was. When I would look at someone or look at an object, I could make out the shape or the form or kind of see the outline, but they would always kind of be in a blur. And until I put my glasses on, everything was kind of fuzzy. But once I put those glasses on, it would clear things up and it would bring them into focus. You know, the Bible tells us that God is spirit. And because God is spirit, that means that God is immaterial. And because he is immaterial, that means that God is invisible, that we just can't see him. And the Lord Jesus Christ is kind of like a pair of glasses and what they are to a person who has bad eyesight. When we put on the Lord Jesus, then we are able to see God. And apart from the Lord Jesus, we will not see God, we will not know God, we will not experience God. And yet when we put on the Lord Jesus, he brings God into focus for us. And that's what these verses are about. They're about bringing God into focus so we can see him. Remember, Jesus himself said that to Philip, he said, "He that has seen me has seen the Father." And so if you want to know what God looks like, how God thinks, how God feels, then you have to look to the Lord Jesus. And apart from him, he will never be brought into focus. So in Colossians chapter 1, beginning with verse number 15, down through verse number 19, that's what Paul is talking about, bringing God into focus. And in verse number 15, talking about Jesus, Paul says, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in the earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things. By him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell." Now, in these verses, Paul continues to do what he's been doing since verse number 1 of chapter 1, and that is to chip away at the heresy that had begun to undermine theological truth in that church that was located in the city of Colossae. And this doctrinal undermining or underpinning, you might say, was something that was being produced by a cult in that city that was known as the Gnostics. And Gnosticism simply was a heresy that was attacking the sufficiency of the person of Jesus Christ. And what Paul does here, and I believe what is the single most profound passage in the entire Word of God in dealing with the person of Jesus Christ, he begins to show who the Lord Jesus really is. And he begins to highlight the sufficiency, the all-sufficiency of Christ. And in these verses, really the theme of these verses, it is the supremacy of Jesus Christ. And when you rightly understand what Paul is saying about the Lord that is contained in these verses, you will see just how supreme and how sufficient that he really is. And he points out six things here, which I believe highlight the supremacy of Christ. Six things in which Jesus Christ is absolutely supreme over anything else or anyone else that is. And first of all, down in verse number 15, he points out the fact that Jesus Christ is supreme in character. In character, when he says that he is the image of the invisible God. Now, the heretics in Colossae, they viewed Jesus as one who was simply among a series, you might say, of lesser spirits that were descending in sequential inferiority from God. And so what they were teaching was that obviously Jesus was not God's equal. And certainly they were teaching the opposite of what Christianity taught, that not only was Jesus equal, but Jesus was God who had come in human flesh. And the Apostle Paul refutes this idea that the Lord Jesus was just some kind of a lesser descending spirit that had come from God, kind of equal with any other angel. He refutes that by this little phrase here when he refers to him as being the image of the invisible God. Now, we know that the Bible says that man as well is the image of God, and yet man, unlike Jesus, is not the perfect image of God. You know, when we talk about man being made in the image of God, we are saying that man possesses, like God, rational personality, which gives man the ability to be able to think and have emotions and to have a will. And so, like God, man is able to think, he's able to feel, and he's able to choose. But when it comes to man in the image of God, man is not in the image of God morally, because the Bible teaches that God is holy, and yet it also teaches that man is unholy, that man is sinful. You know, being made in the image of God does not mean that man possesses those uncommunicable attributes of God, such as omnipotence and omniscience and omnipresence and immutability. Because you see, man is human. Man is not divine. And unlike Jesus, the Lord Jesus is the perfect, absolutely accurate image of the living God. You know, when you look at Jesus, what do you see? You see God. And when we talk about the Lord Jesus being the image of God, he did not gain this image at his incarnation, but it was something that the Lord Jesus had possessed from all eternity. Over in the book of Hebrews, for example, chapter 1 and verse number 3, the Bible says that Jesus is the express image of his person or his character. Jesus made the invisible God visible. That is what John meant in John 1:14 when he said that we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And so Paul uses this idea of Jesus being made in the image of God, and he uses the word image to speak of Christ being twofold, a representation of God and also a manifestation of God. He represents everything that God is, and he manifests the very person of God. In other words, the Lord Jesus Christ is the full, final, complete revelation of God, because Jesus Christ is God who came in human flesh. And dear friend, listen, to speak of Jesus Christ in any other way than to refer to him as God in human flesh is to speak of him and use blasphemous terms, because there is no other way that you can speak of him. And so I think Paul is pointing out here, number one, that he is supreme in his character. But number two, in verses 15b down through verse number 17, he says that he is supreme in creation. He says he is the image of the invisible God. He is the firstborn of every creature. And by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. Now, Paul highlights that Jesus Christ is supreme in creation by making four statements. Number one, he refers to him as the firstborn. The firstborn, in verse number 15, he is the firstborn of every creature. Now, no doubt you have heard heretics like the Jehovah's Witnesses just have a field day with this particular phrase, firstborn. And they would go out and they would teach that the Lord Jesus Christ was the first person that was ever created by God. And yet every time I read that teaching, I say to myself, that is expressing such great biblical ignorance, because that is not at all what is meant by this phrase, firstborn. As a matter of fact, that little phrase there, firstborn, it is the Greek word prototokos, and the word prototokos is a word that could mean first in time. For example, it could refer to a firstborn child, but oftentimes in the Bible, it does not refer to that at all. As a matter of fact, many, many, many times it refers to first in rank, or first in status, or first in privilege, or first in honor. There are several that we read of in the Bible who were called the firstborn, and yet they were not the firstborn child in the family. For example, we read about Solomon, and Solomon was not David's firstborn child, and yet in Psalm 89, verse 27, it refers to him as the firstborn. We read about Esau. Esau wasn't born first chronologically, was he? Or he was born first chronologically, but his brother Jacob was referred to as the firstborn. And so what Paul is simply saying here, when he refers to Jesus as being the firstborn of every creature, he is saying that he is the supreme one in all of creation. There is no one that is his match, no one that is his equal. That Jesus Christ is absolutely supreme. He is first in rank. So when someone says that Jesus Christ was the very first person created, I want to say to them, go read your Bible, because that is not what the Word of God is saying at all. If Jesus were the first one created, and he is also the creator of all things, as this text says, how could that be possible? It's literally impossible. So he says that, number one, he is the firstborn. But number two, it says that he is the creator. In verse 16, by him were all things, not some things, all things, in heaven, those that are in the earth, things that are visible and invisible, all of the angelic world, the thrones and dominions and principalities and powers, all things were created by him. Friend, now listen, the extent of creation is absolutely dazzling to the mind, isn't it? What it's saying is that all things that were created, those things in the heavens, those things in the earth, everything that's visible, everything that is invisible, that all of it was created by the Lord Jesus Christ. All of the angelic world, it was all created by the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you think about just the universe itself spreading millions of light years across, and everything on this earth in which we live, and realize that all of that was created by Jesus, what that tells us is that we ought to be awed by the creative power of the Lord Jesus Christ. I read not long ago somewhere that there are over 800,000 cataloged insects in the world. And there are billions and billions of species within each of those various catalogs. And all of that was created by the Lord Jesus Christ. Friend, want to know why it was that when Jesus walked on this earth and he commanded the winds and the waves to be still, want to know why they sat still? Because he created them. Want to know why it was that when Simon Peter had been out fishing all night and hadn't even gotten a nibble, and Jesus said, "Now cast your net on the other side of the boat," and he did, and he caught so many fish that it tore the net open. It was because those little fish went to that side of the boat because Jesus had created them and they obeyed his command. All was created by him. Now, friend, this is such a simple statement here. This is hard for us to misunderstand. All things were made by him. You want to know what that means? That means very simply that we cannot believe in the humanistic, naturalistic explanation of the universe and everything within the universe and believe the Bible at the same time. Those two are contrary ideas. We have to believe the one or the other. And dear friend, listen, we must believe that all of the creative energies of God Almighty were channeled through the Lord Jesus Christ, who created every single thing, or not believe it. But we cannot mix the creative power of Jesus with the naturalistic, humanistic explanation of the origins of the universe. In fact, do you realize that humanistic evolution is neither scientific nor intellectual? It defies everything that is truly scientific. And yet, even though the theory of evolution and all of the humanistic explanations for the origins of the universe, even though all of these things defy intelligence and defy science, we are still told that we ought to believe that stuff. You know, it's amazing to me the extremes that people will go to simply not to believe God. You know, think about Luke chapter 16, that great parable, verses 19 through 31, where it talks about the rich man and Lazarus, and the Bible says the rich man died and he went to hell. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, and he asked Abraham, he said, "Oh, Father Abraham, would you bring Lazarus back from the dead and send him to my lost brothers that he might witness to them?" And what did Abraham say? Abraham said, "They have the law and the prophets." In other words, they have the Bible. And if they will not believe the Bible, they would not believe someone as if he had risen from the dead. And when it comes to the explanation of the origins, friends, I want to tell you, the Christian faith presents the most reasonable, logical, and rational explanation as to how everything that is here got here. And if a person does not believe exactly what the Bible says about that, it is not because they are too intellectual to believe that. It is because they have set their heart and mind against the Word of God. You see, it's not intellectual not to believe what the Bible says. So the Bible says that He is supreme. He is supreme in character. He's supreme in creation by evidence of Him being the firstborn and being the creator, but thirdly, by being the goal. Now, I want you to look at this in verse number 16, the latter part of that verse, after he talks about Jesus creating all things. And then it says at the end of that verse that all things were created by Him and they were created for Him. In other words, Jesus is not simply the creator of all creation, He is the goal of all creation. Everything is around Him. He brought all things into being and He will end all things. All things start with Him, all things conclude with Him. At His spoken word, He just commanded and everything sprang forth, and at His spoken word again, everything will return to Him. Because He's the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. And everything that was created for the purpose of reaching the goal in the end of bringing glory unto Him. And you see, dear friends, because this is true, does it not make sense that we ought to be living for Him? If He started all things and He's going to stop all things, if all things are in Him and He is the goal of all things, what a waste of time not to live for Him. I love the way that Paul put it back in the book of Romans, chapter number 11, that last verse in the 11th chapter, and sometimes we forget that when the Bible was originally compiled, there were no chapter divisions. And so verse 36 of chapter 11 just moves right into chapter 12, verse 1. And it makes logical sense because in verse 36, Paul says, "For of Him," that's Jesus, "and through Him and to Him are all things, to be glory forever. Amen. Therefore, I beseech you, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service." In other words, based on the fact that all things were made by Him, through Him, and for Him, you ought to be presenting everything that you have to Him. Because He is the ultimate goal of all of creation. Paul uses three different prepositions here, and the prepositions that he uses in that verse is simply his way of refuting the philosophy of the false teachers. For centuries, the Greek philosophers had taught that everything needed a primary cause, an instrumental cause, and a final cause. And when it comes to creation, Jesus Christ fulfills all of that. He is the primary cause because he planned it. He's the instrumental cause because he produced it. And he's the final cause because he did it for his own good pleasure. Friend, it is absolutely insane not to give him the totality of our lives. So the Bible says that everything that was made for the purpose of reaching that goal of bringing him pleasure. But he mentions a fourth thing to prove his superiority in creation, and that is that he is the sustainer. The sustainer. In verse number 17 of our text, it says that he is before all things, and by him all things consist. By him all things are held together. Ever thought what would happen if Jesus Christ just turned loose of the world? It would just explode, wouldn't it? It would go into oblivion. I saw an old medieval painting one time. Not that I was alive back then, but I saw a picture of that painting, and it was fascinating to me because it was a painting of Jesus Christ who was sitting in the clouds, and below him was the world of humans and nature. And in that particular painting, there was a golden thread that was painted from Jesus Christ that connected to every object and person on planet Earth. And that was simply the artist's way of saying that everything is connected to Christ, that he is the one who holds everything in this world and in this life together. Friend, I want to tell you, Paul's great hymn that he's singing here about the person of Jesus Christ, it ought to stretch our puny minds and it ought to dominate our thinking and it ought to change our living to know that this one not only created everything, but he holds everything together. And friends, I want to tell you, the creator and the sustainer, he knows better than anybody else how to order and how to fix our lives. I read about a South American company years ago that purchased a printing press from a manufacturer here in the United States. And that printing press arrived and they put it together and it wouldn't work. So they called the most brilliant minds of their country together. Those minds came together. They did everything that they could and they still couldn't get that thing to work. And so that company that had purchased the printing press, they sent a wire back to the manufacturer and said, "We can't get this to work. Would you send us a representative?" And so they sent a representative, and when the representative arrived, he was a young guy, looked to be about 16, 17, 18 years old. And so they wired the manufacturer back and said, "He's too young. Send another representative." The manufacturer sent another wire back and said, "He made it. He can fix it." Friend, let me tell you something. Jesus can fix us. And when we need fixing, we would be wise to look to the one who made us, rather than looking to so many other things and so many other people. The truth of the matter is, I believe that if we depended upon him more to sustain us, we would need a lot less fixing. But friend, he's the maker, and therefore he is qualified. Listen, he can hold together our emotions, and he can hold together our marriages, and he can hold together our families, and he can hold together our finances. And if you're here today and you're feeling like you're about to break, I'm telling you, there's one who can fix whatever the problem is in your life. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who is both the creator and the sustainer. But there's a third thing here. He is also supreme in the church. And I pray, oh God, give us a revelation of the supremacy of Jesus Christ in this message today. Friend, he's supreme in his character. He's supreme in creation. He's supreme in the church. Because verse 18 says he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. He is supreme in the church. What is the church? I think our vision sometimes of the church is way, 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 way too small. I think that C.S. Lewis, in that great book, The Screwtape Letter, gave us a great description of the church. And C.S. Lewis, in that particular book, was telling the story of the senior devil, Screwtape, who was writing to the lesser devil, Wormwood. And he was instructing that lesser devil on the art of temptation. And he said to that lesser devil that if you want to defeat a new convert, the church is your best ally. Because obviously that new convert will go and join the church. That's the first thing he will do. But then old Screwtape said, there are very few in the church who have ever seen what it's truly like in the spiritual world. So the church is our ally, because most people in the church don't know what the church really is. I wonder if that could be a problem for us. What is the church? The Bible says the church is a building, not a physical building, but the church is a building, listen, that is anchored to the foundation of Jesus Christ, the head. And that means that in Christ we find our salvation, we find our security, we find our support, we find our strength. And friend, as the building, if we are anchored to the right foundation, who is Jesus Christ, we're going to be all right. Amen. So the church is a building. The church is also a bride. I love that picture in the book of Ephesians chapter number 5, how that God says the church is like a bride. God looks at the church as a bride who has a groom who is the Lord Jesus Christ. And when God looks at the church, what does he see? God sees a lovely woman, a lovely woman with a pure character, a thing of beauty that is arrayed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ, who has as her destiny a future to spend with him for all eternity, who is just waiting for that moment when her enemies will be made her footstool. That's the church. And friends, a person that has a true understanding of the church, the demons of hell tremble when they see people like that, because those people know they have the ear of the King, the one who is the head of the church. But the Bible says the church is a building and the church is a bride, but the church is also a body. And just as our physical body has a head, so the spiritual body has a head as well, and that's Jesus Christ. You know, what is Jesus to creation? He is the lawgiver to creation. What is he to the church? He's the life giver to the church. It's as Paul said, that in him we live and we move and we have our being. The church is not simply some super organization. It is a spiritual organism. Listen, that pulsates with the very life of God. That's what the church is. And the church has a head. And that head's not some preacher, not some pope, not some deacon, but the head of that organism is Jesus Christ. He's the head. And friend, if you've been saved by the grace of God, do you realize that the Holy Spirit of God has baptized you into this place that is called a building, a bride, and a body? But there's a fourth thing here. He is supreme in the complexities. He's supreme in the complexities. There are two great complexities of life that we have a hard time figuring out and understanding. And the Lord Jesus is supreme in both of these. In verse 18, it says he's the head of the body, the church, first of all, who is the beginning. The beginning of what? That is simply a way of saying that Jesus Christ is the originator and he is the source of life. That all life sprung from him. He was the one who originated life. You know, when we think about the complex entity of life, who can fully understand that and explain that? It cannot be formulated and it cannot be explained in a scientist laboratory. But it can be understood when we read our Bibles, because the Bible says Jesus Christ is the one who originated life. Do you realize that every cry from a little infant is a testimony to the power of Jesus Christ to create life? He originated life. But secondly, the Bible says that he overcame death, because in verse 18 he's the beginning and then he is the firstborn from the dead. You see, life originated with Christ, and so life from the dead originated with Christ. He is the one who not only designed the womb, but he also destroyed the tomb. He's the one who overcame death. That's what Easter Sunday is all about. You know, when I think about the Lord Jesus, when he sovereignly dismissed his spirit while he was on the cross and allowed them to place his body in a borrowed tomb, the Bible says that he descended into the underworld and he seized the keys of death and Hades. And then he did what he promised he would do. 3 days later, he bodily rose from the dead. He's the one that conquered death. And the great good news is that when we are in him, we share in that glorious resurrection. What does the Bible mean? He is the firstborn from the dead. I go back to our original word, prototokos. It does not mean that he was the first one to rise from the dead in time. That could not be, because we read of at least 6 others who were resurrected. 7, if you think Jonah was raised from the dead. So how in the world could Jesus be 1 and 7 at the same time? It is because when Jesus Christ arose from the dead, he was the first one up to that point who had risen, who would never die again. You see, he is the first in rank, or the first of importance. Lazarus was raised from the dead, but he died again. Lazarus can't do us any good. You put your hope and faith and trust in Lazarus, and you'll die and go to hell. But you put your faith, hope, and trust in Jesus Christ, and you will live forever, because he is the most important one who has ever risen from the dead. So, friend, he is supreme in the complexities of life. But he is also supreme in control. In control. Now look at verse number 18. The latter part of that verse, everything he has mentioned up to this point, it says that he did this, all of these things, in order that he might have what? Say it with me. Preeminence. Say it again. Preeminence. That he might have what? Second place? Third place down the line somewhere? He might have preeminence. He holds first place. He is of the highest rank. And friend, based on this information, I want to ask you, based on everything that we've said about his supremacy, where is he in your life and mine? Where is he? You know, some people give him place. That is, they just bow their heads and invite him to come into their hearts and be their Savior. Some give him place. Some give him prominence. That is, they allow him the general control over their life. And yet there are still those doors in their lives that are locked, that they will not allow him access. He has place, he has prominence, but the Bible says he wants preeminence. He deserves preeminence. And you see, there are some who do that. And those who do that are the ones who allow him to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords over every single area of their lives. That's preeminence. It's not locking him out of any little space in my life. It's giving him it all. And friend, I want to tell you, there is a day that is coming when the Lord Jesus Christ is going to have what is rightfully his. That is preeminence. And that is praise. There is coming a day when the angels from the realms of glory are going to praise him. There is coming a day when the elders and the cherubim are going to praise him. There is coming a day when the princes and the powers are going to praise him, when the dominions and the thrones are going to praise him. There is coming a day when the fallen angels and Satan from the pit of hell are going to praise him. There is coming a day when every lost person and every saved person is going to praise him. But you see, friend, what I want to do is I want to get in on the great joy of giving him preeminence and praise right now in this life. See, here's the problem. The problem is that so many Christians want to just compartmentalize their lives like TV dinners. They have a recreation section over here. They have a financial section over here. They have a relationship section over here. They have a church section over here. Their lives are just dissected into all these various categories, just like a TV dinner is what their life is like. Friend, listen, what do they do? Well, on church, this is Sunday, so this is church day. This is Christian day. Monday through Friday, that's work days. Saturdays, that's hobby day, and that's rest day, and that's relax day. And they live so frustrated because God never intended our lives to be TV dinners. He intended them to be chicken pot pies with everything mixed together, all centered around the main ingredient of the Lord Jesus Christ, so that He has the preeminence when I'm at work. He has the preeminence when I'm on the golf course. He has the preeminence when I'm in the gym. He has the preeminence when I'm riding my motorcycle. Whatever I am doing, He has the preeminence. Friend, would you not say He deserves it? My stars above. Who else is supreme in character and in creation and in the complexities and every other thing that we have just mentioned? Well, there's one last thing here I want to show you, and that is that He is supreme in consummation. Now, I'm the only one that I've ever heard say this, but I believe I'm on to something here in verse 19. Supreme in consummation. It says that it pleased the Father that in Him should all fullness dwell. Now, He did not say that it pleased the Father that in Christ should all of the fullness of the Godhood dwell, all the fullness of God dwell. Now, we know that that was true, and He says something about that in chapter number 2, verse number 10, but that's not what He's saying. What does it mean that it pleased the Father that in Jesus Christ should all of the fullness dwell? Friend, what that means is that everything that has meaning, value, merit, lasting quality, beauty, attractiveness, loveliness, importance, all of that dwells in the person of Jesus Christ. And therefore, Jesus Christ is the fulfillment for every desire for anything in life that we might ever have. And if all of the fullness dwells in Jesus, are you listening? Say amen. If all the fullness dwells in Jesus, then the closer we are to Him, the fuller we are. And the further that we pull away from Him, the emptier we are. Because all fullness dwells in Him. Pastor, I'm empty today. I am so empty. Why? You have pulled away from the only one that can give you fullness in your life. That is Jesus Christ. And friends, if He is, and He is, who the Bible here says that He is, would you not agree that we ought to give Him first place? Let us give Him first place in our marriages, first place in our professions, first place in our intellect, first place in our time, first place in our love, first place in our conversation, first place in our relationships, first place in our pleasures, first place in our play, first place in our finances, first place in our worship. It is a great sin not to give Him first place when He is who the Bible says that He is. And before we can ever give Him first place, we have to first of all give Him our heart in conversion. So if you have not been saved by His good grace, you can't do that. But I believe that you're just like me. As we examine our hearts, we can truly think of some areas of our lives where He does not have first place. This past Tuesday night, I was at our deacon's meeting, and we sang Happy Birthday, led by our chairman of the deacons, Waylon, which wasn't too good. You don't want, Waylon doesn't need to be in the choir. But we sang Happy Birthday to Brother Stan Worsham. This past Thursday was his 98th birthday. He was at deacon's meeting. Now listen, Listen just a minute. As we did that, I said, oh God, help me. Stan Worsham is one of the most committed, faithful followers of Jesus Christ I have ever known. 98 years old. You'll see him Sunday morning. You'll see him Sunday night. You'll see him Wednesday night. You'll even see him Monday night on faith. As this 98-year-old man comes here to pray for those who go out to share the gospel. And you're going to tell me you can't get back but one time a week? You have no excuse. Now, you can get mad at me or you can get right. When I look at Stan Worsham's life, I say, what an epitome of faithfulness to Jesus Christ. And he does none of that to draw attention to himself. He's one of the most humble men I've ever known in my life. And as we sang that to Brother Stan the other night, I said, oh God, I want somebody to say that about me one day. I want the testimony of my life to be a testimony of faithfulness unto you. Why does Stan do that? Because Jesus has first place. Does he have first place in your life? Does he have it in mind? Does he really? Would you stand, please? Our heads are bowed and eyes closed. No one looking around. And Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you will expand our vision as we have just thought about these things. And oh God, I feel so inadequate in trying to expound on such amazing verses. How in the world do we mine all of the rich truth out of these verses concerning the person of Christ? But oh God, I pray that you would give us a greater vision of our Lord Jesus, our Savior. And that would motivate us and compel us to give him first place. And for that one who knows not Christ as their Savior, I pray that today they would come to him and be saved by his grace. For those who need a church home, this is where you've led them. I pray that they would come. And for any of us who need to just utilize the altar to pray or to have someone pray with us or for us, I pray that we would come as well. In Jesus' name I pray. Heads are bowed and eyes closed.